In this episode, I'm going to talk about impact factors on additively manufactured part properties.
So in the previous episodes, I talked mostly about the material and their inherent properties, what we would call the feedstock. Now, in the next couple of videos, we want to talk more about how the process and the feedstock properties combine into the part properties. And for that, let's look at a schematic. We have four big impact factors that have an effect on the process and the properties. That's the machine or the technology in general that we're using, the feedstock, the processing, and then what we do with the as printed part to actually get an additively manufactured component. So when you think of the machine, I put a couple of examples here. For example, the slicing, how that is done, how thin the layers are, the pass planning, how fast do we come back to the same location or next to that location, or are we actually going in circles? That has an impact on the temperature field, for example, and is self-important for the properties. Feedstock delivery, that means, for example, how do we deliver the powder in a powder bed fusion process? Is that out of a reservoir that's already heated to a certain temperature, or is it coming out of a chute? Those are important aspects that have an effect on the layer generation, things like that. And then we have just the basic machine components, like the optics of the laser, which laser we're using, how fast can we trace a certain geometry, and then the heaters. So that could be the infrared heaters in a powder bed fusion machine, but also where really the heat cartridges inside of a nozzle for material extrusion. And in regard to that, where is the thermocouple? So where do we actually measure the temperature, and what is the temperature of the material compared to this temperature that we're controlling for? That's just a couple of examples to give you an idea what effect machine and technology can have. The next we talked about the most already, that would be feedstock. And there we can first look at the production of the feedstock. So again, let's look at powder. If the powder is polyamide 12, then it's likely, or it's very likely, produced with precipitation. So it's a spherical, mostly spherical particle, but if it's another material like a polypropylene, it's probably done by cryogenic grinding, so we'll have a very different surface, and that has an effect on the coating and the feedstock in general. Another thing could be the composition of the feedstock. That means, are there fillers inside? Do we have glass fillers, fibers, beads? Do we have refreshed material, and then in which proportion? The typically for powder bed fusion powders, we use a refreshing rate of 30 to 70%. So 30% could be virgin material, and 70% the already processed powder, or vice versa. And that has an effect because degradation could happen, the shape of the particles could change a little bit, and that all has an effect on the part properties and also on the processing behavior. Then the other things we already talked about a little bit, or you should have gotten an understanding, are the rheological, thermal, optical, mechanical, and other properties that are important, that are inherent with the material. When we come to the process, the most obvious is the process parameters, and that indirectly has an effect on the temperature field. So for example, what laser power are we using, or energy density, what print temperature are we using in material extrusion, what's the layer height, again, and the UV intensity when we think of that photopolymerization, because it has an effect on the temperature field that we're creating, the penetration depths of that light source, for example, And all very important parameters. What we haven't talked a lot about is the part orientation. So I take this part, for example. It's a difference if I print this like in this orientation, so mostly oriented in the XY plane, or like this, where it's this is actually the build direction. Because when you look at, for example, how the laser would trace it, the laser would go all along and it would take quite a while until it would have melted the whole layer that we want to generate. On the other hand, if it would print it like this, it would take very little time in comparison to actually melt that layer. And if that's the only part we're printing, for example, we would come to the next layer much faster, and potentially this previous layer would stay much hotter. The same, obviously, that's a powder bed fusion part, the same would be true for material extrusion. We would take much longer to fill out this geometry compared to this. And where that could be a real game changer is look at this bobblehead, where you have the very thin neck section. So in that section, if you think of it as done with material extrusion, you would have very little time for the material to cool down until you go to the next layer, and that could result in a geometry that's not as precise, because we're actually not allowing the material to cool, but it would weld really well. So that's just a little excurs on part orientation. There's obviously other factors, and they depend strongly on the process we're looking at. And then also the as printed part. What surface finish do we have? How good is the dimensional accuracy if we think of this as part of an assembly? Here, obviously, the assembly is printed as is, but if that goes into, is one component in a bigger assembly, dimensional stability is important. And the density that we achieve in the process, because that has an effect on the mechanical properties. And then we also have the finishing. So if the surface is very rough, do we actually polish it? That has an effect on the AM component if we use it unpolished and it is, for example, rougher, then we get stress concentrations in these on the surface. If we smoothen that with whatever technology, then we get rid of those, but obviously our part becomes more expensive. And then for materials that are printed or components that are printed with binder jetting, we could also have a coating and infiltration process afterwards that obviously has an effect on the component. So that should give you a picture of the different impact factors. And now let's look at the polymer powder bed fusion process that you're already very familiar with. You can check out the previous video and videos if you're just tuning in now and get a better idea of how the process works. But what I wanted to remind everybody watching right now is that we have the powder delivery from the powder supply moving upward, a roller taking the excess material and depositing it on top of the build platform or the powder bed, and then we have the laser tracing the component and the geometry of that particular layer of the component, and the not molten powder is actually acting as the mold of that part. So Manfred Schmidt from Inspire in Switzerland created a very good overview. Right now, the previous schematic was looking at all the impact factors. Here, we're only looking at the impact factors on the feedstock material. So we're taking that small portion out, and you can do that as detailed as you want to better understand your process. So for the powder bed fusion material, what's crucial is the particle, the shape, the surface, how it's manufactured. That becomes then the bulk of the powder. And there it's important, for example, what humidity do we have? What's the chemistry overall? Is it prone to condensation, like a nylon 12 powder? Oxidation happening, how can we recycle it? The size distribution, and how good does it flow, how good can we code it. And then from the bottom here, you see aspects of the properties, like what the optical properties, what's the absorption at the wavelengths of the laser, how much does it reflect, how much does it transmit, how easy is it for the energy to penetrate into a certain depth, the thermal properties, what modulus do we have as a function of temperature, the expansion coefficient, how much does it expand and shrink, the melting behavior, obviously, the conductivity, how far is that the energy from the laser conducted into the melt down below and also into the solid powder surrounding it, and the rheology, the melt viscosity, for example, how good do the particles coalesce once they're hit by a laser. And that's another way of diving deeper into one process and look at the individual aspects in a lot more focus. And that's part of the next episode, talking more about this particular schematic of powder bed fusion and the properties that are relevant.